Hey, what's up guys? Will here for GSM Arena. The iPhone 11 is the cheapest model of the 11 series, and the successor to last year's XR. What's been upgraded since last year? And compared to the Pro versions, what sorts of trade-offs would you have to live with? Let's find out in our full review. Looks-wise, the iPhone 11 doesn't bring many surprises. It's quite similar in appearance to last year's iPhones. It's made of ion-strengthened glass on the front and back. Its frame is made of brushed aluminum though, rather than the stainless steel you get on the more premium 11 Pro models. The iPhone 11 comes in a set of new colors, and the purple one we have looks snazzy and fresh. Plus, the new square camera setup makes it stand out. Compared to the Pro model, the finish here isn't frosted, but glossy, so it will get smudged more easily, and isn't quite as scratch resistant. The water resistance has been bumped up from IP67 to IP68 this year, so now it can survive under 2 meters of water for half an hour. The Pro models can go twice that depth. The size is quite comfortable in the hand, a bit larger than the 11 Pro, but still okay for one-handed use. Actually, the dimensions and weight are the same as last year's iPhone XR. Along that same vein, the iPhone 11 screen is also exactly the same as the XR's. It's a 6.1-inch IPS LCD with a sizable notch cutout, and a pixel density of 326 ppi. The bezels are thicker here than on the iPhones with OLED screens. You get used to it, but they do stand out when you first see them. Just like last year's XR, this screen is excellent, with good contrast and accurate colors. The True Tone feature will automatically adjust white balance based on the ambient light. And though the panel isn't quite as sharp as the Pro model's OLED screen, it was hard for me to tell the difference with the naked eye. However, something the iPhone 11 doesn't offer is HDR10 support, or Dolby Vision, which are available on the higher tier models. It does bring the same low touch latency though, thanks to 120Hz input polling. It's a nice boost for gaming, but sadly, the screen's refresh rate is still capped at the regular 60Hz. Maximum brightness is good. We measured up to 640 nits with a manual slider. There should be no problem using the phone outdoors. Unlocking the phone is quite secure with Apple's Face ID, which uses 3D facial mapping. It's quite fast as well, but still requires you to swipe on the screen after you've been recognized. For audio, the iPhone 11 Pro has a pair of stereo loudspeakers. They're not as balanced as those on the Pro model, which has more bass from the top speaker, but they still have a rich sound, with very good measured loudness, and support for spatial audio. It's no surprise that there is no headphone jack here, and Apple still doesn't bundle an adapter. But you do get earpods in the box that you can plug directly into the Lightning port. The iPhone 11 runs the latest iOS 13.1 at the time of review, and is quite familiar, though it does bring a few new features to the table. One such feature is a system-wide dark mode, which can turn all of your white menus into black ones. Unfortunately, since this is an LCD screen, you don't save power like you would on an OLED. But hey, it still looks cool. Another change from before is that instead of 3D touch, which activated context-sensitive actions based on the pressure of your finger on the screen, now there is only haptic touch, which triggers things with a long press. There have been some upgrades to the photo editor, which has many new options and filters, and intensity sliders to give your pictures just the right touch. And it's not just photos, there are plenty of options to customize your videos too. Just keep in mind when taking lots of photos and videos that storage isn't expandable here. If you end up buying the 64GB option, you might run out of space pretty easily. Inside the iPhone 11 is Apple's new A13 Bionic chipset, and along with that is 4GB of RAM. Performance here is just the same as on the Pro version. That is to say, brilliant. It's unmatched by anything in the Android world. The iPhone 11 aces benchmarks, providing 20% better CPU performance over last year's chipset. It does a great job at staying cool too, thanks to heat-dispersing graphene layers, so sustained performance for something like heavy gaming is great, without much thermal throttling. On top of that, the A13 is more power efficient than last year's chip. The iPhone 11 has a 3100 mAh battery, just a little bigger than the XR's, but battery life is much better here. We measured a great endurance rating of 94 hours in our proprietary battery tests. This is even better than the iPhone 11 Pro, perhaps due to the different power draw from the screens. There's support for 18-watt fast charging like on the Pro models, but here, it doesn't come with the phone. You only get a 5-watt one that charges the phone from 0 to only 18% in half an hour, whereas the faster charger would get you up to 55%. There's support for Qi wireless charging too. Apple doesn't make a charging pad, so you'll need to use a third-party one. Moving on to the cameras. Plural here, unlike the iPhone XR's single camera. Now on top of the 12-megapixel main cam, there's a new 12-megapixel ultra-wide shooter. The thing that's missing though is the third telephoto camera that comes with the Pro version. In daylight, photos from the main camera have rich detail, impressively low noise, and excellent dynamic range. They aren't perfect though. Colors are accurate, but if you enjoy a more vibrant look, they seem a bit bland and washed out. Contrast is a bit lacking, and there is some over-sharpening. One interesting feature is called capture outside the frame. When you snap a photo with the main cam, the phone will also take one with the ultra-wide too. Then, when it recognizes that you accidentally cropped a person out of the frame, it will suggest a wider angle that fits them in. The feature also works for videos. The ultra-wide cam itself is pretty average as far as these type of cameras go. There's no OIS or autofocus. Quality-wise, photos from this camera are decent, with colors, contrast, and dynamic range matching the main cam. But there is some visible noise, and we wish there was more detail. Portrait mode uses the main camera. In good lighting, you get nice detail and colors. But unlike the iPhone 11 Pro, this setup doesn't use a second camera for depth mapping, so the subject separation isn't quite as good, with some defects here and there. Moving on to nighttime photography. When the light gets low, the iPhone 11 will automatically switch to night mode, and will take a pseudo-long exposure shot. The quality of these is superb. There's plenty of detail, balance sharpening, excellent colors and contrast, and balance exposure. We didn't get a single blurry photo while shooting either. If you opt to turn off night mode, the results are still good, with plenty of detail and low noise, but the exposure is darker. There is no night mode on the ultra-wide cam, and if you try to shoot with it in low light, the results are pretty bad. This year's iPhones bring an upgrade to the selfie camera. It's now 12 megapixels with a wider 23mm lens. Depending on the orientation of the phone, the selfie cam will switch between the new wider field of view or a cropped one similar to last year's. Or you can toggle it manually. The selfies use Smart HDR and their quality is top-notch. There is more than enough detail, balance sharpening, and great dynamic range. Colors are accurate, though still a bit washed out. The selfie cam can now take video in up to 4K at 60fps, and it's stabilized. It all works quite well, but there's no autofocus here. You can also take slowfies, which are what Apple calls slow-mo selfie videos in 1080p at 120fps. It's kind of gimmicky, but you can have some fun with it. Videos from the rear cameras can also be taken in up to 4K at 60fps. They all have EIS and can use Smart HDR, and have wide stereo sound recording too. 4K videos from the main cam look very good, with plenty of detail, low noise, spot-on sharpness, impressive dynamic range, and true-to-life colors. The colors actually don't look as washed out as in still photos either. 4K footage from the ultra-wide snapper is average in quality. It's lacking in detail and the corners are soft, but there are still good colors, contrast, and dynamic range. So that's the iPhone 11. Though it is the budget option, it still brings some top-notch features, like a water-resistant design with plenty of color options, a bright LCD screen, nice stereo speakers, world-class performance, great photo quality, especially at night, and really good battery life. So what about the shortcomings? Well, compared to the Pro versions, you don't get the brilliant OLED screen, or the telephoto cam. And the glass on the back isn't frosted, for what that's worth. Also, the lack of a proper charger in the box is kind of insulting. But overall, the iPhone 11 still brings pretty much the same experience as the Pro versions, at a much more competitive price. It's even cheaper than the XR was. At $700 for its 64GB option, it's still far from a budget phone, but it's definitely more appealing than $1,000 and deserves a recommendation. Thanks for watching guys, and see you on the next one.